morning and welcome to this grab and go session this morning, where we will talk about how we recently have experienced an acceleration in remote working. Changes that many of us have predicted would happen over decades took place in the span of weeks and months. We've seen people become digital natives. So people who never used to open emails on their iPhone, they are now playing with funny backgrounds and just like they used their mousepad before. Companies and organizations also experienced an increased productivity during these corona times. And today we are going to focus on some of the learnings as well as some of the challenges that we need to learn from to keep this momentum in the longer perspective.
Yes, so this is what we will discuss today. What were the experiences that we had during the pandemic? And what was the learnings and insights that derived from there? And finally, but not least, what is a solution framework that we can propose how to implement some of these learnings that we want to keep? We're excited to see so many here today. Great to have you here. If you want to engage with us, please use the chat function and ask questions as we have put time aside in the end to Q&A. Mm.
So before we dive into it, just a short introduction of us, your speaker is here today. So my name is Camilla Alm and I am head of our organization transformation department in Deloitte Consulting. I've spent the last more than 15 years helping big companies drive tough changes, mostly actually on your side of the table. And for the last 3 years as a consultant, where my focus has been helping companies build their digital DNA. So what does it mean to be a digital organization and what does it require to shift and transform?
Yeah, my name is Stine Deinegaard. I am director in transformation leadership. I have a background as researcher. I have a PhD in co-creation and human-centered design from Stanford University. And I've been helping companies set up both business models and also workspaces that centers or have the outset of the human beings, like real human beings, and not necessarily only the function or the architecture or the design. So real people. And as you can see on the right-hand side, this is some of the work that Camilla and I have joined forces to create. So when COVID hit back in March, we merged our competencies and experiences and created what is now the Deloitte Thought Leadership on how to work virtually. And this entails both how you can conduct meetings and workshops virtually, how you lead your team through the lens of your computer, and also how to set up your workspace in a way at home, in a way that doesn't, it will drive you insane. Okay. So speaking of March 2020, it was quite crazy. We created this within, you know, a couple of weeks, actually. Crazy times. And we actually have a small video this morning also to get us going. That kind of explained how March 2020 was for us. So let's see if we can put on the film. 2020, what happened?
That speaks for itself. So speaking of COVID and the feeling and what we learned about working remotely, we would actually like to hear from you. So please take out your phone, go to menti.com and enter the code that you see here on the screen, or use the QR code. And what we would like you to do is answer those questions that you see in here. So what surprised you the most positively when working from home? So I'm more efficient in my work. You can choose up to three options. I have experienced that my work itself has changed a bit. I have improved relationship with my clients.
And I can take the fourth. Yeah. While you find
the technology.
So number four is I have a more personal relationship with my boss and colleagues. Five, so I have an improved relationship with my sweatpants. And, or six, the sock drawer is neatly arranged and the house is clean. So what surprised you the most in the positive way?
So please go ahead and vote. So you can choose up to three options. And right now, I hope you can all see the screen. It seems so sweatpants is truly competing with efficiency at work. Yeah. I like it.
Yeah.
I like it a lot.
We're starting to see a clear pattern, actually.
Yes, absolutely. So it's really between efficiency and sweatpants. Mm-hmm. I wonder what's the correlation between those two.
Yeah, yes. We need
it's
a new dress code.
Yeah. We also have quite a few that experience that work itself has changed a bit. That's interesting.
That's super interesting, yeah.
Especially because that's part of what we are going to talk about here today. Mm-hmm. Not that many people seem to arrange their arrange their socks.
No, Marie Kondo didn't answer.
No. And the relationships, no, okay.
With clients is still
a different. Yeah, it really seems that efficiency is the one that that won.
Yeah. So efficiency and the sweatpants.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you very much for this. Mm-hmm. And
let's get the presentation
back.
Thank you. So thank you very much for sharing all these experiences with us. And as you you can tell, they are all elements of the concept of future of work and what we are going to talk about here today. What you see on this slide is actually a quote from the New York Times that very early on actually defined the COVID-19 situation. So from a work perspective, as a time machine to the future, accelerating what a lot of companies had already started on.
Yeah. And as you can see on this slide, here we have a lot of clips from papers that companies worldwide have experienced these positive side effects of remote working or working from home. So some of them are quite recent, and they show how companies are really starting to experiment and implement this new, more hybrid workspace or work situation. Mm-hmm. And in June 2020, Deloitte conducted a European workforce survey, reaching out to more than 10,000 employees in seven European countries. And they say that 80% say that the move to remote working has been easy, that 76% feel as or more productive working from home, also what you stated, actually.
Absolutely.
And 64% state that they want their employers to put in place for flexible working hours. And this is very interesting. So there's no doubt that future of work is happening all over and is happening super fast. And companies are embracing it.
Yes, absolutely. We can see that everything is pointing in that direction. However, Zoom fatigue is also catching up on us. And I think that's a new word that we all have recently learned in the last couple of months, Zoom fatigue.
Yeah.
And actually, the same survey that we just talked about, it also reveals that some of the downsides from working from home, we hear that almost an hour has been added to our day, to our work day, leading to 38% feeling exhausted at the end of the week. And actually, 37% of the asked employees in this survey experienced some sort of negative effect on their well-being. And so what they tell us, 40% lack focus, and the same amount, 40% feel isolated. So the feeling of being alone. Mm-hmm. 34% struggles with their work-life balance. I think we can definitely say we've had some of those pictures with kids running around. Yeah. And 34% find it hard to adjust to these new work dynamics. And finally, only 18% feel challenged due to inadequate technology.
Yeah, and again, also reaching out and engaging virtually, we would love to have your view on this. So Camilla, if you once again find the Menti, you can find your phone again and go to menti.com. It should open on the same browser, because it would be interesting to see you rate yourself against exactly these elements. So how would you rate yourself on a scale from 1 to 10 against these elements?
You just need to shift.
Yes, there you go. Thank you. What were your biggest challenges working remotely? Lack of focus, feeling of isolation, work-life balance, new work dynamics, or you felt that the technology was inadequate? Yeah. There, something is happening. Mm. Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah. Inadequate technology is taking the lead right now, and then work-life balance, yes. Mm. Mm-hmm.
Focus, isolation, yeah.
So it's pretty even, I
think. Yeah, it's following about, but I still have a tendency to the focus, isolation, and work-life balance is taking the lead.
Yeah, and I think also what we see during the first period is different from the second here. I think the isolation feeling maybe hit us faster this time.
In the second time around.
These votings, of course, we're also going to share with you when we send out the slides. And while you flip back to the presentation, thank you very much for sharing. We can also say that some of the what you say here is also what we discovered in our survey. Because besides just looking into competencies and virtually facilitating workshops and meetings, we also conducted a survey among leaders and employees among our clients, asking them what they thought what surprised them both negatively and positively. Mm. And these elements are actually very much aligned with what you say, both the downside and certainly also so the upside. Mm.
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. So now, as Stina just said, we discuss both the upsides as well as some of the hardships of this new work situation that we are all in. So the benefits, but also the challenges. And it's obvious that the work and the workspace and the workforce, us, we've changed. And technology has enabled us to stay productive and on track. But in terms of future of work, we have not yet changed towards a holistic view on technology. So we still see technology as an enabler for us to work virtually. But how can technology help us organize ourselves in a new way so that it's not technology we focus on, but work itself? Mm-hmm. So we therefore need to look at technology from a different angle. So not just as an enabler for what we traditionally have used it for. So the use of technology has been focused on efficiency, cost reduction, optimization. It's been about making existing systems and structures faster, cheaper, and often by substituting humans with technology. So work, you can say, in the broad term, hasn't fully translated into true value. So it's time to re-architect work. So it's really about people, it's about technology, it's about the workspace, but more importantly, it's also how we organize ourselves. So technology forces us to look at how we organize and how our work delivers value. So Stine, why this picture of a milk centrifuge?
Yeah, that's really modern technology. No, that's a good question. So the first Danish Cooperative Association was founded in 1866. Here, some farmers chipped in to be able to buy a milk centrifuge. Mm-hmm. Not exactly that model we see on the screen, slightly older version, I would guess. But this new piece of technology enabled the farmers to be more productive and also to produce better quality milk and also deliver new innovative dairy products. Mm-hmm. So the farmers joined forces and organized themselves differently in order for them to acquire this piece of technology that again then helped them improve their business, as we would say in a modern language. So the point of the story is that technology, new technology, enable us to more than just cost reduction, efficiency and optimization, as you also said. So technology allows us to reimagine, to re-architect the work itself and the value that we deliver. And if we do not organize ourselves around technology differently, it will be the same as just putting electricity to the paper, and we will not reap the full benefit. So the question is then, how do we shift from using technology as a fancy lemon squeezer, you could say, you know, squeezing the last drop out of people and processes and really making the most of it, to using it in a way where it really makes creates value and add meaning. So we've taken a framework or a solar system with us today, because we would like to become a little bit more hands oriented here. We would like to show a little bit about how you can think about this and also how you can actually start doing it. So to the first point around how can you think about this, we would like to show you this framework that can help explain what we mean. Hmm. As said, it's a solar system with something quite important in the middle and something circling around. So if you look in the middle, here's the customer. It means that the customer should be at the center of everything we do, and that is, of course, not new. But when it comes to re-architecting world work, then the customer should also be at the center of this effort. And then you see something circling around it. This will what will deliver value to the customer. The first one is workforce. You can say it's the humans and the machines that in an ever larger degree work together. So this is what many organizations are focusing on these years: automation and machine learning and artificial intelligence and so on. And how these technologies substitute manual tasks and optimize processes. So the second planet is then the workspace. And as we showed today in the newspaper clips, this is what is really hot topic right now. How can we transform the workspace itself in a more hybrid way? So the third actually is the work itself, or whatever delivers the value. This is not something we hear so much right now. Then we need to look at how work creates value for the customers. We've learned that people, organizations have reinvented themselves overnight when we ask them. People did whatever they needed to deliver value, a new value to stay relevant for their clients. So the work itself changed. This is also what you said. Mm-hmm. And actually, I think staying relevant here is the key. So again, the customer centricity. So these three elements are, you need to look at all three to re-architect work. Then you see the an outer ring of them. This is to show that it's an iterative process. It's not a one-off, now we fixed it, it's done. No, you need to re-architect, then unleash your people, and then adapt to this new way of working in an, you know, ever ongoing circle. And finally, on the outer ring, you need to organize for this. You need to set up a structure that allows for this. Otherwise, again, it will be a one-off. So Camilla, would you elaborate a little bit on how to actually do it? Because now we talked about how you can think about it.
Absolutely. So so the second part is the how to. So as Stine mentioned, it starts with the customer, but you have to make sure that first of all you set the strategic direction, deciding where you want to go, re-architect, unleash and adapt. What we just mentioned before, that you continuously reiterate these steps And finally, you design the change journey. So how do you communicate and actually set up a good change plan? And making sure that the entire organization is committed around the strategic direction. So let's dive into to these three. Let's try and unfold them a little bit further. So first of all, when you want to establish the strategic direction, there are three focus areas that you need to consider. So we talked about the customer, and here you need to do your homework. So sleeves up, head out of the bushes, interview, to talk to your clients. When did they see that you actually deliver value, and have they experienced anything different during these corona times? What is value and what's redundant? You can use survey, interviews, or basically any other means that that will bring you this this knowledge, because you need this homework. And once you have done it, you need to look at how your workforce can deliver the value. So what does the workforce actually require to deliver this? What are the needs and the pains? And what are the, this make no sense to do it in this way? You also need to look at potentially dive into the success stories on the floor. So those stories where your employees succeed that does not necessarily get the praise. Finally, you need to consider how you as an organization deliver impact to the society. So are you pushing products, or are you delivering a service that step by step makes the world a better place? Be articulate about it, because this is why you are in business. So step one is all about doing your homework and gathering data for step two.
So step two, one of the rings, re-architect, unleash and adapt. It's time now to do the analysis. You've gathered the data, now it's time to look into it and look what are then, you know, popping out. Where are you actually excellent? When are you truly delivering value in a super cool way? Mm-hmm. So you need to discover this and formulate this. Then pilot it. Mm-hmm. Unleash your workforce and have them test it out. They will find ways and workarounds to make it happen. And if they need a new platform or a new tool or something, then buy the license to make it happen. Unleash them. And the third part is then learn from it. How can you make your workforce adapt to this way of working? Make sure that you harvest the learnings and discover the barriers. Mm-hmm. What are the barriers for the workforce, for the workspace, and how you deliver value? Because your next step is all about making it real, mm-hmm. large scale, removing these barriers and starting the transformation. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. So the third phase is the transformation itself. As Stina said, you now need to start the transformation because you've set the strategic direction. You discovered the value that you can achieve when you unleash your workforce. And now it's time to actually start the transformation journey and execute on strategy. So the barriers that you identify might be that you need new technology or new tools that needs implementation. That can be a new delivery platform, a collaboration platform, or an online service offering. But this needs to happen. But we also know that technology implementation often meets policy and legal resistance. So for example, we're not allowed to use a certain type of technology. And these barriers, they need to be removed one way or the other. Thirdly, there's a change journey. So for your employees, it needs to be communicated. Some might need to be trained. All the classical elements of good change management, because this is a new culture that you will be implementing. Mm.
So to sum up, actually, future of work is about unleashing your employees to do the right work in the right way and in the right space to serve the clients best. And before we move into the second part, the Q&A part, we have a short video, a wonderful video, to show you a little bit of what we mean. Not to say that we think that we are ostriches, but what technology enables us to do.
Yeah, things we could have never imagined.
Exactly. So please play the film.
She packed my bags last night, pre-flight. 0 hour, 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. It's lonely out in space on such a timeless flight.
Yeah, it's a wonderful film, we must say, even though both abstract and a little bit funny. But this is what we also should think about in terms of technology, that it can set us free to do things we didn't even imagine before.
So thank you to those of you that have put in questions. Please use the chat function. So yeah, we will get them in on the iPad here. And let's start with a couple of the first ones here. So do we need completely new skills in this virtual age? Or should we surrender to robots? Regards from Casper. Well, dear Casper, I'm not exactly sure about the robots that you are referring to, but I think, as we talked about today, it's everything is around making making it a hybrid, right? So how do humans and machines work best together? So how do we make sure that the machines are supporting the work that we do? So instead of replacing us, we can actually spend time on some of, you know, these more innovative, meaningful, impactful, delivering value to our clients. Maybe we can even learn to fly. Yeah. Who knows?
And yeah, so also, as Camilla say, the working together is what we see a lot when organizations is starting to automate manual processes. Mm. It of course takes people to design the best possible process, so we don't just electrify the current process, but we rethink it in order to add more value. And then it's of course the employees that feeds this information into the systems. And what we actually see is the more confident that the employees become working with automation and with the machine learning, what they start to see, helped by technology, are some patterns that they couldn't see before. Some ideas automatically just pop up. Well, we can see that if we do it this way, and what we see are employees starting to turn away from technology, the computer, and facing more towards their colleagues or clients. So one of the skills that is required in a more digital age is actually, that might sound a little bit weird, skills to conduct interviews, for example, and client survey, and more interactive skills towards both the clients and employees. So there will definitely be some new skills required.
But hopefully the robots won't take over all
No, long. I'm imagining this picture that I'm not going to share, but best of luck to you, Kasper, and thank you for this question. So then there is another question, I think, around for us. So what has surprised you the most during the lockdown?
Mm-hmm. That's a good question.
Yeah.
Well, for me, it was definitely... But some of the same things, actually. How extremely productive we were able to be all of a sudden, really, you know, juggling work and the everyday life in a completely new manner. What actually I think surprised me was the level of forgiveness that we showed towards one another. So we forgive each other for poor connectivity, when technology fails, when something is not perfect in the setup. We kind of forgive each other more that you're on some scrappy lines on your iPhone because you really want to make it happen. So I think that surprised me the most. And what about you, Camilla? What surprised you?
I think both the innovation power and the productivity, especially in the beginning of the lockdown. So despite the fact that it was super stressful with kids and balancing, you know, work-life balance, I think definitely also the productivity and the innovation power. And just coming back to this, I think that's also what we heard from the companies that we spoke to in that period, that the innovation power, innovation was everywhere, they said.
Yeah.
And I think that's also a little bit the subject of today, and back to the robots and the machines. So how can we make this innovation happen everywhere by using technology in the right way and organizing ourselves in the right way? Mm-hmm. So very, very interesting. Mm-hmm. I think we have time for one more question, maybe two. So are you able to share your thought leadership on the learnings from working virtually from Maria?
Yeah, of course, we can send this out with some of these learnings, what has surprised others. Definitely we can send that out with the PowerPoint that comes after this. Mm. I think this one is also good. I'm not a millennial, and I find it hard to acquire new digital skills. What skills should I focus on? That's a super good question.
Very relevant, yeah.
And I think instead of thinking, we have these shelves with a lot of tools and I need to pluck these skills and acquire them and where to start, it would be more relevant to go to colleagues. When we conduct leadership training, for example, and really focusing on the new digital skills that you need in this leadership group, well, we start by looking at what do you use today? Do you use your app when you go and shop online? How do you go on social media? What is actually what do you do today? And then when you look at again the work, what is required from you? Where could you optimize? Are you very analog and printing out emails and walking around? So looking at what you're doing today in a close group in your company, and then helping each other saying, okay, what would be relevant? Again, back to relevance. What would be relevant to optimize? So instead of thinking a lot of new skills, then start with one or two that you agree on in a small group, because it makes it more bite-sized. It makes it easier to start working on.
Yeah, and it's all about habits, right? Mm-hmm. And what we learn from speaking to these leaders is definitely so the barriers of not doing things in a different ways and so on. It's all back to the patterns and the habits. So how can you actually determine and commit together with your colleagues one step at a time is definitely what we see is the most successful, and that can be anything to making sure that you download your expense claim app and you actually do your expenses in real time. I mean, that's also a digital skill instead of like me collecting a ton. I shouldn't say that.
No, we're actually not that digital yet. That's the same. My quality is extremely full.
The point definitely is it's not everything on the same time.
Yeah.
So best of luck
we have time,
to you on your digital skill building. Yes, we have time for one final question.
So my organization is mainly analog in its way of working. What is an easy way to digitize teamwork? Regards from Isabel. And
I love this question. What is an easy way to digitize our teamwork? Maybe there's not an easy way. No, but it's definitely, again, it's something that you need to decide between, like in the group, how do you work most efficiently or in the best way together? And also deciding on some ground rules. So this is definitely something we've been working with companies around, establishing the ground rules. For example, in the morning from 9 to 12, it's work time. This is not where we have meetings. This is a time where you can set aside and really focus on the work. You will not be disturbed. And then in the afternoon, this is the time where we allocate meetings, for example. So we decide this in our team, when to work, when to deep dive in order to keep focus, and when to collaborate. So that is definitely one way. Another way is also deciding on one day a week that you meet physically, either in the office or outside. So yeah, on with the big jackets now. But design actually your way how to meet physically in a way.
It's all about structure, right? And putting it into a structure and deciding on. So it's not different than when we moved into the big open floor offices where people also like, but when, how do I signal that I'm in a meeting and where do I go? And so I think it's the transformation into something new and structure and planning your work and making sure there is transparency around is definitely key. And I think some of the principles that we have worked with companies on, I think technology is the least important thing because it's just deciding on one tool or the other, but the structure is what is going to keep you connected.
And just another note on that, we talked with one leader who has asked his team members to send him an emoji every day just to state how the mood is. So there are different ways to stay close and connected and be creative in how you use the technology, because the connectedness is very, very important in establishing good teamwork. And it is difficult, and we don't have a script for how to do it because we're in new grounds, all of us. So really being creative about how to stay close to each other. So it's that balance between the closeness and the unleashness, I guess, is the key for the future of work.
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. And I think that sums up also very well our theme of today. So from here, thank you very much for listening in and joining us this morning. It was a pleasure, and we will make sure to share with you the presentations we showed here today.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.